Now, let's look at gross premium results, which is again looked at as a natural extension to net premium results. In the net premium results, we have computed the results, both prospective results, which is based on the future value of the benefits as well as the future expected future value of, or probably expected present value of the benefits and expected present value of the future premiums that are going to come. Or we have even done the calculation for retrospective reserve, wherein we looked at the future value of the premiums paid till date and the future value of all the expenses that are expenses as well as the claim payments that are paid till date. Now, this is where I'm looking at extending the same to the concept of gross premium. Just like the way we were able to compute the net premium reserves from the net premium, net future loss random variable. Here we will find the gross premium reserve from the gross future loss random variable. Right, we can very well find out by finding the expected value of the gross future loss random variable. I can very well find out the prospective reserve because it's an expected present value of the future benefit. So the prospective reserve at any point, I can try finding out by using the gross future loss random variable and finding the expected value of it. Right. Now we have to really keep in mind whatever the gross premium that we have computed at the time of initiation of the policy. Whatever the assumptions we have made, whatever the basis that we have set, right? Now, if all those are similar, now it need not be similar also, right? See, the calculation of the reserves, it is purely done based on the gross premium valuation basis. Now, what we are trying to say is this mechanism, this assumptions here may or may not match with the assumptions that I have taken for the computation of the gross premium. If these two are the same, probably this is what will try to lead us to a situation, one of the mandatory conditions where I may have my prospective reserve being equal to retrospective reserve. Right? If at all the reserve for the computation of the reserve, whatever the assumptions relating to the mortality, relating to the interest, relating to the expenses, relating to the bonus, if at all those for the computation of the reserve as well as the computation of the initial premium at the initiation of the policy, if these two remain the same, probably that is one condition where I can match my prospective reserves with the retrospective reserves. But again, this valuation basis can be completely different from this particular valuation basis. That's one thing that we have to understand. The gross premium, whatever we are using, is directly the charged gross premium. It is not recomputed based on the reserving basis. That's one more point. We are not recomputing the gross premium. Just like in case of net premium, we were doing the recomputation of the net premium based on the reserving basis. But here, what we are talking of is we are looking at only the gross premium that is getting charged, not the recomputed gross premium based on the reserving basis. So, if I have to simply bring out the future loss random variable, okay, S times AX plus T. If at all I am assuming, let's say, the benefit is paid on a continuous basis. At time period T, the present value of the death benefit, the present value of the expenses, there is no initial expense anymore at X plus T, but I may be having a recurring renewal expense. So that's the reason I have taken it as a annuity, and here it is more or less at the beginning of the period, right? The renewal expenses, and at the same time I may have some terminal expenses which could very well be associated with the death benefit, so I'll take that. And probably no other expenses because initial expenses are not there. And whatever is the premium that is received, the gross premium that is received in the future, I may still have to receive gross premiums at the beginning of the period. So this is what will become my loss, expected loss random variable. And this is what will the expected value of this expected loss random variable is what is going to give me the prospective reserve, right? So here what we are simply saying is the valuation basis for computing this may or may not match with the valuation basis which we have used to compute the premium long time back. Even in this, I can very well accommodate the bonuses also. But again, there is no clear-cut definition in terms of what kind of bonuses need to be included. If I have to really go back to try to understand in case of net premium reserving, we did not consider the future bonuses at all. Only the bonuses that have been declared till date, we have considered only them as a part of the reserve computation. So whereas here, it's not that clear as to what bonuses have to be allowed for, how they should be typically treated into them. But regularly, what we generally see is at least I will add one way is I'll add the bonuses whichever have been declared till the date of computation of the reserve. But if you look at the premium computation, the G, it might have already taken into consideration the bonus, right? It might have already taken into consideration the bonus. Now that entire G we are discounting back. So even the future premiums, they are getting deducted by the amount of A double dot X plus T, which means it's not just the non-bonus part that is getting discounted, even the bonus part is getting discounted, right? All the loading for the bonus is directly getting discounted. So there is I can very well include the future bonuses also. That's an argument. I can very well include the future bonuses also because I am anyhow discounting the gross premium, which already includes a loading for the bonus. If I am not including the future bonuses and if I am including only the past bonuses, then probably my reserve is going to be a very, very conservative, very weak kind of a reserve. So that is where I have to be really prudent of, really careful of. Do I really require that much of a cautious approach, right? If I am calculating the benefit, allowing only up to the bonuses that have been declared till date, but I am deducting the entire future value of the gross premium, my reserve is going to become more and more weaker, right? So that's the reason. At least some portion of the bonus, future bonus, is included as a part of the future benefit, right? So probably at least the terminal bonus may or may not be included, but at least the regular annual bonus would generally be included to make sure that the reserve is not that conservative. That's one important dimension that we need to remember during the associated with the gross premium reserve. Now, when I'm looking at the same from a retrospective basis, right, which is the future value of whatever has been paid till date. Now, we are taking into a consideration for a time period T, we are initially starting with anything that is incurred between 0 to T. We are trying to find out the value at time T. Whatever we have paid for the premiums, whatever, so what is the amount that might have been paid for the premiums? Let's say G times AXT would have been the present value of all the premiums that I would have received. So I will try to compute the future value of this. So if I have to compute the future value of this, it's always better that I multiply it with dx by dx plus t. This is a measure of future value because this is what is getting incremented by a power of 1 plus I to the power t. Similarly, the payment, S is the death benefit. Now, what is the death benefit that that would have got paid between x between 0 and t? AXT would have got paid. So all the death benefits that have been paid till time period T, I'll deduct. Whatever the initial expenses are already incurred. So that is already gone as an expense. The renewal expenses, whatever have been paid till date from X to T, that multiplied by DX to DX plus T. Then similarly, the terminal expenses, whatever I'm having, even those terminal expenses, whatever got paid till time period T. All this is what is contributing to my retrospective reserve. So prospective reserve is getting, on one side we have the prospective reserve. On the other side, we are having the retrospective reserve, and we know that in some cases there is an equality between the two. So this is my retrospective reserve. I know my prospective reserve for the same example. I can take it as SA X plus T, right, plus RA double dot X plus T plus T A X plus T minus G A double dot X plus T. So this is what is coming out as a prospective reserve. Now there are some cases where the prospective reserve and the retrospective reserve may be equal. But first of all, if you see in all these computations, what are the various assumptions that I am making? One, I'm making some kind of assumption regarding the mortality. I'm using some kind of tables for computation of all this story. Then I'm making an assumption regarding the interest rate, 4%, 6%, whatever is the interest rate. Then I'm making assumption regarding the various expenses that are going to come up in future. And I am also making some kind of an assumption regarding the premiums, like the premiums are paid at the beginning of each period. No premium is typically omitted. There is no delay in the payment of the premium. Even for expenses, renewal expenses are always associated with the day of the start of the policy year. No expense would be delayed. With so many assumptions we are making. Now, what we are simply saying is, when will these two reserves be equal? Whatever is the mortality, the interest rate, or the expenses, whatever we have used, right? Whatever the basis, whatever the assumptions that we have used, these should be here while doing the reserves also, whatever the assumptions that we are using, these should be the same as the date on which we have computed the gross premium, right? So on the date when I have computed the gross premium, whatever the assumptions I have used regarding these three, regarding the future expenses, future interest rate, the same kind of assumptions need to hold even today at time T. Then there is a possibility that these two can be equal. And the gross premium that is found out on that particular day, it has to be purely based on the equivalence principle only. Only when the gross premium is calculated based on the equivalence principle without including the profit part, right? It has to be going purely based on that day. Probably it should have got computed as GA double dot X should be same as SAX plus I plus RAX plus TAX. Now, if this is the assumption that has gone into it, if the premium G is decided purely based on this expression, and the assumptions that have gone in terms of computation of the reserves at time T are same as that of the assumptions that have gone in terms of the computation of the premium at time zero, it is in that occasion where we will see that the prospective reserves would be same as that of the retrospective reserves. So we need to be comfortable with the conditions under which these two would be the same, because that is what will tell us, is it okay if I calculate the reserve on any of the mechanisms, or is it better that I calculate it only on a prospective reserve basis, or only on a retrospective reserve basis, or anything else, right? Then, finally, we also, in case of net premium reserve, we even came out with a recursive relationship. Especially if I want to find out the reserve for the period T plus 1, we tried a kind of an equation. If I looked at the reserve for time period T, right? If we are looking at a reserve for time period T plus the premium that was charged during the time period at the time of issue of the policy, these two, if I am investing for 1 year at the interest rate I, we said that this entire thing is going to be equivalent to some QX, the probability of death, times the death benefit that is going to be provided, which is S, plus the probability of this life being alive. And if it is alive, I'm talking about the reserve part of it at the end of T plus 1. So this is a simple relationship that we have derived in case of the net premium reserve. So the current reserve for T plus 1 can be computed from the reserve from T through this kind of a mechanism. Now what we are simply talking of is the same logic with small extension, because all the expenses do come into picture. So instead of the premium at time period X, now I am talking of gross premium. But of course, the gross premium minus the expenses that are paid during the time period T. Right? At time period T, if I am removing the expenses that are typically being paid, this entire amount I will invest it by I as an interest rate. Now this is what I would see as QX times. On death, there are two benefits that are getting provided. S is the death benefit and T is the terminal expenses that are getting incurred. So QX times, I have to play S plus T. QX plus T times. Even here, it is QX plus T because the death in year X plus T. Similarly, P x plus T times the reserve that gets built, T plus 1 Vx. So this relation comes when I am considering the gross premium reserve. Probably we can very well look at deriving this in the same way we have derived even for the net premium reserve. So if I look at PVX here, I know the typical form for it is S AX plus T, the death benefit, the renewal expenses, right, R A double dot X plus T, the terminal expense, AX plus T, minus the premiums which are coming every year, G A double dot X plus T. Now I know AX plus T, I'll try to express it in terms of T plus 1. So it is as good as the probability of death, right, a present value of that, which is by discounting it by V, plus the probability of survival times the present value for the next year, AX plus T plus 1. Present value, which is V. The same logic I can put for A double dot X plus T. I'll write it in form of X plus T plus 1, where I'm getting it as 1 plus the probability of survival P X plus T times A double dot X plus T plus 1, the present value, which is V. So I can very well do the substitution for the same. Let me look at it. TVX is S times QX plus T times V plus PX plus T times AX plus T plus 1 times V. Similarly, so the same logic I can very well extend it for both S plus T here. And similarly, I can very well extend R minus G. I can extend this logic. 1 plus PX plus T, A double dot X plus T plus 1 times V. Right? This is what we are trying to write. So, I could simply look at a simple reordering now. Now I can look at it as TVX, right? If I look at it as, okay, the first part, SVQX plus T plus TVQX plus T plus this part, if I am taking R minus G. Now, for the remaining, I'm talking of Px, whichever is having the Px plus T term, right? Px plus T times V, if I take it out, it is nothing but S times Ax plus T plus 1 plus T times, right, plus T times AX plus T plus 1 plus R times A double dot X plus T plus 1 minus G times A double dot X plus T plus 1. Now, this is what it is coming out. So, which means I could very well talk about it as SVQX plus T plus TVQX plus T plus R minus G. Now you look at this. What do I write it as? PX plus TV. And probably all this is what? All this is T plus 1 V. The reserve at time T plus 1. If you look at this expression, this is nothing but the reserve at time T plus 1. Now probably you have the whole story with us. TVX, now this G minus R, whatever I can pull it out, right? TV, and probably here I can take the V out extra. I can take the V out of the remaining, because if I can look at it like V times SQX plus T times QX plus T plus PX plus T times T plus 1 VX. Now this V, if I get it down, V is nothing but 1 by 1 plus I. So TVX plus G minus R times 1 plus I is nothing but S plus T times QX plus T plus PX plus T times T plus 1 VX, which is what is the recursive relationship for the reserve at the end of time period T plus 1. So all those things whichever we have discussed as a part of the net premium reserve computation, that entire fundamentals are going to remain similar even when we are getting into a gross premium reserve computation. The only difference now being we have to consider the various expenses and the commissions and the various aspects that come which are associated with the gross premium but are not associated with the net premium. Even the bonuses are considered, which are not present as a part of the net premium approach. Right, when we take up a few numericals on the same, we'll get much more clarity on the same. But conceptually, having a broad level of overview is very much important for us. All right.